Now, he's a barefoot, stand-up, unclassical guitarist. Richard Durrant joins me now in the studio to talk about all things guitarist. And also, let's start off, Richard, by discussing why you go barefoot when you play. What's that all about?
The barefoot thing, well, it's a busy life being a musician. You know, there's an awful lot of things that you have to do. You know, the admin, the driving, the travel, the hours of practice, the writing. So the bit where I'm actually on stage is actually quite a small part of my life, but it's the special part. And the stage for me is like a little sacred area. So when I play, I spend all day preparing that, you know, for whether I'm in a theatre or an art centre or a church. That's my little space. And I've been living in it all day. And then I welcome the audience in, and I'm the host, and I play music to them. And it just feels very special to be in that space with bare feet. I get upset if a big technician comes along and clumps across it in great big boots.
But isn't that quite dangerous to be on stage barefoot? There's all sorts of things, like little nails on the floor.
It's not like working down a mine or something, you know. It's quite a controlled environment.
Very true.
You're quite safe. And I take my shoes off when I go in people's houses. It just feels, it makes it more special. It's magical enough as it is. But to take your shoes off as well makes it more so. It's not a gimmick, it's just something which I've been doing for years and years. Don't even think about it anymore.
Sandy Shaw did it for a long time, didn't she?
She did indeed, yeah. The comparison has been made.
Okay, so you've got a new album out, The Girl at the Airport. Tell us about that.
Yeah, The Girl at the Airport is a completion of a trilogy. It's a four-year project which started with a trip to Paraguay. I was recording some music by a great hero of mine, Agustin Barrios, who is a great Paraguayan guitarist, and I've loved his music since I was a kid. And I was invited over to launch this album and to tour over there. And when I got to Paraguay, I realised that the country was absolutely packed full of wonderful music, great musicians, and I became friends with quite a few writers. So I've discovered repertoire that's never been recorded before, that's never been played before. So I then made the second album, Hijo de Hombre, which I launched in 2012 over in Paraguay. And this latest album contains music that I've written for guitar and string orchestra, as well as unreleased material by Paraguayan composers. So it's a bit of an adventure. And the title, The Girl at the Airport, it's a bit of a Graham Greene thing, really. The first track is called Our Man in Asuncion, you know, Our Man in Havana, that kind of idea. So it's a very kind of evocative storybook of an album which sees me travelling to Paraguay. And the title track's The Girl at the Airport, I recorded with the City of Prague Philharmonic Orchestra back in July.
Did you go to Prague to record?
I did, it was great, yeah, it was a wonderful experience. Yeah, they're a great orchestra, a lovely studio, sumptuous sound. And at the launch gig, which is at Rope Tackle this coming Thursday, the 29th of October, I've managed to cobbled together an orchestra of wonderful string players from Sussex. So there'll be a 15-piece string section on stage with me, with the guitar and the projections and all the usual fun.
God, fantastic. I bet that was amazing to do.
It was truly wonderful, yeah. He just phoned up, hello, is that the Prague Philharmonic? Can I book you? Yeah, all right, yeah. How much? No, it was lovely. It was lovely. They built me a little soundproof shed at the back of the Philharmonic. And I went in there with my guitar, and I could see the conductor, and he could see me, and off we went.
I bet that was an amazing experience. Now, the rest of the album was recorded on Shoreham Beach.
Yes.
Not the most natural place to record an album, on a beach.
Not on a beach, but, you know, it's where my house is, where my recording studio is. I'm a very lucky man. I have a 15-second commute time when I'm recording. So I've got a very lovely studio in Shoreham on the beach, and it's where I've done most of my recordings for the last... I've been there since 1999, so a long time. I was quite young when I moved there. So lots of things have been recorded there, from the Ukulele Orchestra of Great Britain through all sorts of fun has taken place in that studio.
Now, you released a documentary back in 2008, didn't you? Tell us about that.
Oh, goodness me. Yeah, that was made by Phil Grabsky, who is a Brighton filmmaker. It was wonderful to work with Phil. He's an incredibly talented guy. Yeah, that was me wandering along the South Downs, wasn't it? Yes.
Indeed. So here we go. What's going on here? That's you wandering along the South Downs singing. Are you barefoot? I presume you are.
No, I've got my walking boots on. I'm not singing. If I was singing, you wouldn't be showing it on the telly, believe you me.
So tell us about the history. So what made you decide to do this?
I do a lot of walking. I do a lot of cycling as well. On Latest TV last year, you screened my cycling documentary, which I made on an iPhone. I decided to do one of my concert tours by bicycle, and I cycled 1,500 miles with a trailer with a PA in it, which weighed 40 kilos, and filmed it all on an iPhone. I learned to edit film during that adventure. So you've also shown that. It's just constantly finding new ways of sort of exploring what it is to be a musician. There's so much involved. I'm also a composer, so I'm constantly looking for new forms of inspiration. When you come to, if you ever come to one of the Girl at the Airport concerts, you'll see a lot of art is projected up. A lot of it is created by Mark Charlton, who's a Shoreham-based artist, but it's influenced by the Italian futurists. That wonderful aviation artist who could go up in aeroplanes for the first time and look down on the planet, and you know, a real feeling of speed, quite similar to the vorticists actually. So the visuals coupled with the music are tremendously important to me. So, you know, whether it's making a documentary or commissioning animations, it's close to me as a performer and as an artist.
Where did it begin for you, performing? Your love of music, where did it start?
Love of music, I'm one of six kids, three girls, three boys, grew up in Hollingbury when it was a rough old council estate. It's probably quite posh now, Hollingbury.
It is.
Amazing.
It's very posh.
And yeah, I used to catch the 26 bus along to my guitar lessons with the wonderful Mary Curd, who taught there in Waterloo Street. But my mum belonged to the Brighton Record Library, and my dad, although he was a toolmaker and worked nights all week, so I didn't see much of him, at the weekends, when he wasn't having a snooze, he listened to Django Reinhardt records. So my mum used to get Julian Bream out of the library and lots of other kinds of music, and my dad would play jazz at the weekends.
Were they supportive, your parents?
Oh, yeah, really. I mean, I'm the second youngest, and I did have to nag to get my first guitar lessons, but then that led to cello lessons and then composition and, you know. And my advice would be, if you like music, then if you're obsessed, if you've got a child that wants to learn and he or she has the bug and is obsessed, they will do the practice. You need a bit of gentle pushing at first, a bit of gentle pushing, the right tuition, learn to read music, and then hopefully it will just, the obsession will bite.
But you do need to be obsessed, don't you?
You can't
go into this industry saying, oh, I'll give it a go, let's see what happens, let's put a few feelers out there and off you go. You have to be very, very dedicated, don't you?
It's the same whether it's gymnastics, music, probably any profession. If you're determined and if you're focused and you keep going, then you will get there. You will be able to play a bar chord without any pain. You will be able to earn a living, although that's much more difficult now. That's a whole subject, that is. Things have changed.
In what way?
Musicians. Streaming has come along. There's a fantastic liberating effect that the internet and that kind of exponential technology curve has done for us musicians. It means that we don't have to spend money going into studios. We can have a beautiful recording studio in your MacBook. You know, you can do these things and you can market your music, but it's very tough to earn money from music unless you just get out there and gig. So you've got to go out and tour and gig the whole time.
But with streaming, it must be a lot easier for people to access your music.
Yes, it is, but they pay very, very little for it. And that's also, you know, raked off by the internet companies. I actually believe that companies like Virgin and BT and TalkTalk, they know what's coming out the end of the pipe. They should have a total accounting system where the music that you listen to is distributed equally amongst the people that own the intellectual copyrights. That's what always happened with radio and television, and it should happen with the internet. It's a very, very it's a very subtle, strange thing to begin to understand, but the effect is that instead of being able to afford a car that you can leave in a swimming pool as a musician, you really do struggle to earn a living. You know, it's different. I remember when I was a kid, my hero was Charlie George, who scored the winning goal in the 1971 FA Cup final. He was every kid's hero. He was just the centre forward of his day. At the end of that cup final, he got on the tube train and went home on the tube, on the underground, you see, because he probably couldn't afford a car. And probably that same week, you know, Keith Moon went and bought himself six Rolls Royces or whatever. You know, things have changed very much, perhaps for the better. Who knows? But, you know, Wayne Rooney gets paid a fortune, and musicians don't.
They don't?
No.
That's very true.
But if you go
unless you're at the very top of your tree.
Say again?
Unless you're at the very top of your tree.
At the very, very top, yeah. I mean, there are exceptions, of course. They're kind of freakish examples. But, you know, that's a very peculiar part of the industry. I think there's longevity in the part that I'm in. You know, you can go out and play and write. And for me, it's my life's work.
The two things that I noticed looking at your guitar. Firstly, it has no hole in the middle. Now, I'm sure there is a technical word that somebody...
It's called a sound hole.
It's called a sound hole. So it's not that technical.
Yes, a bit of a clue in the words there.
Yeah. So it's not got one of those.
Nope.
And also it's got lots of clocks and watches and things at the top.
Yes, these don't affect the sound that much, they just affect my mood. You see, I've got a compass up here and my dad's watch out of the biscuit barrel on the sideboard at home. And this is the key, which cost me a lot of money actually, that's the key for the little wooden box that Sir Edward Elgar used to put his moustache in at night.
Right.
but these are just kind of mementos to keep me happy when I'm away touring.
The so guitar, this is the equivalent of a musician having stickers all over his guitar case.
It's a bit of steampunkery and tomfoolery.
It is steampunkery. Which,
it also weighs a ton, but the rest of the guitar is very, very heavy as well. So it's a very unusual instrument built by a guy called Gary Hearn. It's my signature model, so it's called the Richard Durrant Concert Guitar. And the top is glued to a very chunky plywood frame, which crosses where the sound hole would be. So it's constructed in a quite a groundbreaking way. And the end result is a guitar that sounds like a grand piano. It's a, well, more like a guitar, you know. It's, at last we have a Steinway Grand to play. It's a big beast of a thing. And it's got this little filigree thing up here. And a lot of, you know, kind of classical purists wouldn't entertain the idea of playing something that isn't completely normal. But then that's the classical world for you. And what I said to Gary was he could get some sound hole stickers made.
Ah, that's a good point. Now, if I saw you out and about, I would immediately, without your guitar, I would immediately know you're a guitarist. How would I know that, do you think?
My nails, perhaps.
Quite correct. Yes. Show everyone your nails.
Here's my nails. Where's the camera? Where are we?
Short nails.
Over here. Right, so on your left hand, you can have them as short as you like, because you need to get your fingers on their bony tips. That's the art of it, you see. With this hand, you articulate and you don't pluck, you push the note with the right hand. You pluck a harp, you play in a different way on a guitar, but you need a playing surface that is beautifully smooth and predictable, and you get a nice clean contact. So there's an awful lot of business that goes on in my dressing room with bits of wet and dry to polish them up. And I just protect them with a coating of bio gel, which the little beauty salon in Shoreham High Street do for me. They're my friends in there.
Now, do people ever take the mickey out of you for having one hand?
I'll tell you what, since I used to catch number 26 bus when I was a kid, I've always been fiddling with my nails. This coating of stuff, I experimented with things when I left on my first bike tour for my cycling music adventures. I needed something that I could, you know, I could change brake blocks and get inner tubes off and not snap my nails. So I've been wearing this ever since, and it's great. For the first time since I was 4, I don't have to worry about my manicure.
You don't, absolutely. No. Now, in a moment, we're going to hear you play live for us. But before that, we've got a clip here of your arrangement of Debussy's Arabesque No. 1. Let's have a listen to that. That's beautiful.
It is beautiful, isn't it? The animations are fabulous. They're done by a local artist, Miranda Vincent, who also did the cover artwork for the first of the trilogy for the number 26 bus to Paraguay. It's the first album that I took over to South America. And it's beautiful what she's done with the Debussy. I gave her a rough recording of it, and she did that fairly quickly, actually, at home. I think she used a pane of glass and sand and all sorts of weird stuff. But I've played that piece in concert for years. It's a bit of a cheat. Live, I play the beautiful top line, but because it's quite a major piano piece, you can't do the whole thing live. So I've made this kind of fantasy guitar by tuning strings down and recording bits, and so it's all glued together. It's never going to be as beautiful as Debussy's original, because that's perfection. That really is an iconic piece, but it's very, very pretty and people love it.
When it comes to classical composers, what's your favourite to play?
Bach, probably, but I really don't like using the C word, classical. I call it the C word. It's a bit of a turn-off, you know. It stops you being able to get into venues, and it stops people buying tickets.
But you see, you call yourself an unclassical
musician. I do, yeah.
What do you mean by that? Because you play classical music?
Because I play whatever I'm interested in, and this thing is a real chameleon of an instrument. It's a wooden box absolutely bursting full of music and stories, and it's not... I hate the thought you could just play Villa-Lobos on it and nothing else, you know. I can play... I've just been to Spain playing Tubular Bells and a Jethro Tull tribute.
Now, Tubular Bells. So, that's a check. Can you do a bit of Tubular Bells?
I could, yeah. I mean,
I love Tubular Bells.
Oh, it's such a beautiful thing.
It is. It's a beautiful track.
Yeah, iconic little thing. And it's really lovely to be able to play unexpected pieces of music, like Django Reinhardt and Mike Oldfield and the other, my own music, alongside great things like Debussy's Arabesque. And people don't think they're coming to a classical concert, they think they're coming to a kind of curious guitar concert with projected artworks and commissioned animations. The whole thing is a very carefully prepared presentation that I hope people feel is worth the ticket money. That's my plan.
Okay, that's a good plan. It's a very good plan. Let's hear some more from you then. What are you going to play for us? How about something for your new album?
Well, because I've just completed the trilogy with The Girl at the Airport, the new album. There's a little solo by the guy that started it all for me, Agustin Barrios, who I first heard on Christmas morning when I was in Hollingbury in 1971 on the B-side of a record that my mum and dad got me as a Christmas present. This recording by Elirio Diaz with three precious tracks by Agustin Barrios. And this really set me on the course of exploring South American music, you know, and let's hear it.
The guy, give us a minute.
The guy is
just a minute.
Wonderful, yeah. Lovely music.
How long does it take to prepare something like that? I mean, you can't just go in and play it instantly. It must take a long time to practice.
It does take a while. The first thing is to memorise the piece and study it and decide how you want to play it. And then really it's a matter of going out and gigging it and playing it live in front of people. That's when you really begin to understand how a piece works. And then, of course, the recording is an even more intense approach to the piece, but most of the work that I do on pieces is out on the road, and my big practice time is the warm-up for a gig. That's when I do a lot of work. I'll get into a venue at 11 o'clock in the morning and I'll just be there on stage playing until dawn.
Okay, very briefly, because we've just got about 20 seconds left, where can people hear you next?
Rope Tackle Arts Centre. There are a handful of tickets left for Thursday night. But I have a very extensive Christmas tour coming up, which is the big tour for me. I'll be going all over the UK, so look out for the Christmas gigs. But look out for The Girl at the Airport, the new album.
Indeed, the new album. Richard Durrant, I've loved it. Thank you very much indeed.
Pleasure.